us, the live video feed. It's the Joe Pag Show. Glad to have you here. Really glad to have this guy on. He's from campusreform.org. His name is Joseph Silverstein from Cornell University. Joseph, how are you?
Joe Pags, it's a great honor to be on the show. I'm a big fan. I watched your episode with Lacey and many others, and I'm honored to be here.
Well, I appreciate that, man. It's really good to have you on for the first time. Get to campusreform.org, where you're going to see these young reporters do great journalism, and I believe put the mainstream media to shame every single day. Got a bunch of stories to jump into. I always like to start here, though. You're a young guy. You're a happening dude. You want to see your friends. You want to see your classmates. You want to see the attractive person in class, whatever. And I also learned very well by being in front of the professor, in front of the teacher. You can't really do that right now. Are you still going to Cornell, and are you doing it online? How are you doing your education right now?
Well, nowadays, we can't even make the joke about the attractive person in the class because you'll get canceled.
That's right.
But that being said, so Cornell actually is offering classes in person and online, and most of the classes are being offered online for my major. I'm an economics major. Actually, all of them. None of them are being offered in person. So I decided to stay home, save a little bit of money on the housing and tuition. But look, I wish I could go back to campus, but instead, it's going to be what it is, and that's unfortunate.
You know, I'm 54. I'm a hermit, so I don't mind being at the house. But you guys are young, and you want to meet people. You want to just find out what's happening with your friends and pop culture and whatever else. You know, being locked in, we hear about depression and things like that. Is there any sign that they're going to let you go back to class anytime soon, or this is going to at least be for this semester?
This semester is going to be a rough semester, so I'm not sure what percentage of the population is going to go back. It's open to everyone. First, they were guaranteeing housing on campus that there would be space. Now they're not doing that since the quarantine situation sort of changed. But, you know, it's interesting, too, because they expect everybody, and I'm not anti-mask, but they expect everyone to wear masks all day for all of their classes. It's negative 13 degrees up there in Ithaca. It's snowing all the time. They don't want you in the cafeteria. Right. You're supposed to pick up your food and go. So what am I supposed to do? Eat Chinese food as I'm walking to my next class in the snow? You know, so...
I got you. No, it's a great point. So hopefully things will get back to normal sooner than later. Again, it's Joseph Silverstein. Go follow him at Silverstein USA on Twitter. I can't follow you because I'm suspended from Twitter. That's another story for another day. Let's get into some of these great stories that you and your counterparts over at campusreform.org are covering. One not too far from me at Texas A&M. I guess it's in vogue to wish the death upon anybody from COVID-19 that you disagree with. And this guy is getting away with it. Fill me in on this.
So this is Professor Felipe Castro, and really a sick person when you read the tweets. He made statements that he was happy that Herman Cain died. He said that the Trump administration, the people are physically deformed. He compared Trump to Nazis. He actually retweeted another professor that Campus Reform reported on recently that was arrested for trespassing during a Black Lives Matter riot. So this is someone, he celebrated the death of Herman Cain. And if this were the other way around, he would be canceled. Cancel culture we talk about. If this were a conservative professor making a horrible, unjust remark about, say, John Lewis, for example, the man would be fired, his head would be on a stick, and maybe to some extent, rightfully so. But when a left-winger says it about a centrist or a conservative, it's okay. They get a free pass.
So it's very strange because people like you and I would call him out. If somebody said that about John Lewis, we would not stand by and allow that to happen. For some reason, on the left, not only do you get away with it, but many people will celebrate a guy like this.
Absolutely. And part of the reason is because the radical left views anyone they disagree with as racist, as sexist, as homophobic, as the enemy. And so anyone who gets in the way of their radical neo-Marxist agenda, because that's what the universities are promoting, they want to see them dead. It just happened recently with a professor that committed suicide. The professor was a conservative professor. I forget the university, but he had committed suicide. And the Washington Post even ran an article. The headline was very negative about him. Students were celebrating online the fact that this man killed himself. It's a sick world we're living in.
It really is. It is Joseph Silverstein from Cornell. And to that point, there's a professor now who's threatening to punish anybody who, again, disagrees with him politically if they're pro-life or if they're anti the group Black Lives Matter and their views. Where is this happening?
So this is at Iowa State University. There's a professor in the English department of all places, not the best track record for that subject, but in the English department, Chloe Clark. And she stated that certain viewpoints aren't going to be allowed. She said that criticism of Black Lives Matter, for example, which is a political organization, by all means, totally political. And it happens to be a neo-Marxist political organization, self-proclaimed. But that would be met with severe punishment and actually being thrown out of the course. The same goes for criticism of LGBTQ activism or of support for pro marriage, pro-traditional marriage viewpoints are not to be tolerated. So this really shows you, Joe, the disregard that these people have for the traditional values that this great republic, that this great country was built on. They don't care about freedom of speech. They don't care about individuality or freedom of association. It's their way or it's punishment.
Well, what's interesting is that if you go to the website, the Black Lives Matter website, it literally says who they are and what they're about. They want to they want to dismantle the Western nuclear family. They are pro-LGBTQ. They're not really about black lives. They're about trans black lives. And if you go through, you find out who the founders are, look them up, and they're admitted and glad to say they're Marxist. So in this professor's class, you're telling me I can't do the actual legwork and the research and say, hey, professor, just to let you know, this is what I learned from Black Lives Matter. She would shut that down?
She would shut that down. And the university spokesperson actually came out and said that this goes against the university's commitment to freedom of speech. It was removed from the syllabus and the professor was reprimanded and spoken with. But that being said, the university only did that to stay face. We see this happening at universities all across the country. This isn't an isolated incident. It's written into the syllabus that you have to use the preferred pronouns and defy biological science and other things. I mean, this isn't an isolated incident, and you'll see that as we get into some of the other ones too. This is a trend, and it's been a trend, and it continues to get worse and worse, this problem.
It is Joseph Silverstein from Cornell. Make sure you go follow him, Silverstein USA, over on Twitter. To that point that you just made, it used to be that universities, like Berkeley especially, was the haven for free speech. We're going to push free speech. The First Amendment, God love it. It's a part of our value system. We're going to fight for it, even if we have to die fighting for it. But now you're telling me at Princeton, there's a graduate student government council that is saying that you really can't have support for free speech. They're calling it unacceptable. What is this?
So this one's really absurd. Essentially, the university administration and the president put out an op-ed and a statement in support of freedom of speech, saying that freedom of speech and other values such as equality are not in contrast with each other. The graduate student government was not happy with this, and so they released a statement really bashing on the administration for even supporting freedom of speech. They said, quote, "We as a student body are not looking for a dialogue on how to cope with institutional racism." So this is the same tactic. If you disagree, you're racist, you get shut down, you have your career ruined, and we see this happening, and it's unfortunate.
What's interesting is when somebody brings up systemic racism, I can dismantle that argument immediately. When they call it institutionalized or institutional racism, I can dismantle that as well with fact. But they're literally saying we're allowed to say systemic or institutional racism. You cannot counter us because we don't want you to have the same right we just took in saying something like systemic or institutional racism. Am I hearing you right? They can say it. I can't respond.
100%. That's as similar to what happened with Goodyear with the tire company. I mean, this has been happening at universities. I think one of the things, and Joe, you do a great job highlighting this for your broader audience, but mainstream America hasn't seen this before. This has been a trend on college campuses now for decades, and it's been increasingly worse and worse, increasingly designed to silence freedom of speech. And now it's bleeding into the mainstream culture, and you see it in corporations as well.
It drives me nuts because we're spending a lot of money to send our kids to college, or they're getting grants or even just student loans that they've got to pay off for years and years and years. And we're paying for the right to have these professors indoctrinate the young people. And what you guys have found at Campus Reform, and I've reported this for years now, is that if you actually give the counter argument to students, they're smart enough to digest it and they make their own decision. But there really is a purposeful move on these campuses, no, Joseph, to not let them know there's another side.
Oh, 100%. That's why there's such a disproportionate representation of liberal professors to conservatives. It's 12 to 1. And not to veer off the topic too much, but our own faculty advisor for a student organization that I run, a conservative student organization on campus, Professor Jacobson at Cornell Law School, they boycotted, they threatened to fire him, they petitioned him, all because he criticized Black Lives Matter. So again, this isn't an isolated incident. This is something that's been happening and continues to happen. And it's very intentional. This isn't a byproduct of the movement. This is the movement. They don't want freedom of speech because their ideas are terrible. Yeah. I only wish that the right and the Republicans were as good at selling good ideas as the Democrats are at selling BS.
And they're not. And you're right. And you're right to call them out. In fact, Ted Cruz called them out recently. And others have been calling out the Republicans. You've got to get a backbone, and you've got to make sure that you give the counter argument. And don't just say, well, let's get along with the other side. The other side never really wants to get along unless they're the ones that are getting what they want. It's Joseph Silverstein from Cornell. It's Silverstein USA over on Twitter. And go make sure you check out every story in campusreform.org. One more quick one. And we highlighted this story before here on the program. There was a college student that was in trouble because the background of his Zoom meeting or whatever it was, whatever the class was a support for President Trump. He was in big trouble in hot water, and they were made all sorts of new rules. Did they back off of that now?
They did back off. Actually, we reported yesterday that they dropped all but one of the charges, and this morning I read that they dropped all of the charges. But the fact that this even had to happen, I mean, I hardly consider it a win for freedom of speech, because the person may not even go back to the doctoral program that he's a part of. It's really an unfortunate thing, and all this for supporting President Trump. So this is what is a result of this radical movement.
What's interesting is the fact that we highlighted it. I'm not taking any credit. You guys highlighted it, and we ended up reporting on it. That got some traction, and then they had to respond. But how many stories like this, and I know you don't have a real number, but I'm guessing there are many stories like this that never see the light of day, and students are having their free speech rights squelched every single day without any thought about recourse. How do we implore them to report like this guy did? Because this person was in big trouble until he wasn't in big trouble because we highlighted it.
Well, one of the things I would say is to reach out to organizations like Campus Reform and other ones to highlight this. FIRE did a great job. It's a legal firm that deals with cases like this. And also to confront it in the classroom yourself, to confront it head on. Don't be afraid to articulate yourself and say what you feel very bluntly. I mean, there's been times at Cornell, for example, a very liberal university, a very liberal institution. Not that it's all negative. I'm very grateful I go there. But that being said, though, I've had to have silent victories where I'll email the professor and I'll say, you know, what this student said to me is inappropriate. What you said to me in the classroom is inappropriate. So you also have to be willing to be your own attorney and your own advocate and to really be bold in defending freedom of speech.
And I think a lot of times people don't think they have that right. They, in fact, do. And you know what? You're paying the salary of the person that is restricting your rights. It's Joseph Silverstein, Silverstein USA over on Twitter. Go follow him. Go to campusreform.org every day like I do and check out these great stories from these wonderful young reporters. Joseph, great to see you. Hopefully you'll do it again soon.
Absolutely. A great honor. Thank you so much and good luck with the show.
Thank you, brother. We're back after this in the Joe Pags Show. Stay right here.
Joe Pags.